Say that next week. We'll have something else to say, because next week is Pentecost, the birthday of the church, and I encourage you all to wear red next week. I see some of you got a head start on it, and that's great. You can wear the same thing next week, no one will remember. So welcome, I'm glad you're all here. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Thank you. Let's share with each other a sign of God's presence and God's peace. Please be seated as we share with you a few brief announcements.
Thank you for worshiping with us today. We're glad you're here, and we trust the Spirit will move you. Please fill out the worship card and place it in the offering plate. Chancel flowers are placed to the glory of God by Richard Hoover in memory of his brother, Gary. If you would like to purchase one or two bouquets, in honor or memory of someone, please sign up on the flower charts in the fellowship hall. Today we will have noisy offering following these announcements. We accept change or paper. Monies collected will go to the Social Service Emergency Fund in downtown Long Beach. Following today's worship service, we ask that you join us in the fellowship hall for an important but brief congregational meeting. Lunch is provided. Everyone is invited. It is very important that all members attend so we have a quorum to address the following items on the agenda. Members will ratify the members of the call committee, approve the representatives for Synod Assembly to be held in a week or so, approve the amendments to the Constitution as prescribed by Synod, Election of church council members. Only one council member's term will be ending, but they are eligible to run again. We also have room to elect a few more council members. Use the nomination slip to nominate yourself or others. Those already serving are listed. Put the slip in the jar out front. And finally, today is Birthday Sunday, where all May birthdays will be celebrated during the dessert portion of our lunch. Adult education is in recess until... Somebody else is controlling my mouth today. Help! Adult education is in recess until further notice for both the Zoom class on Wednesday and the Sunday morning class at church. On Saturday, May 27th, from 10 to 12, volunteers are needed to take down the Easter cross and change the paramounts and adorn the sanctuary for Pentecost. Phil is out of town today, but let him know if he will be available to help. They should be back tomorrow. Next Sunday will be Pastor Steve's last Sunday at Gloria Day, with worship here at 10 and on Zoom. We will meet for his retirement party at our Savior's Lutheran Church, 370 Juan Apero Avenue in Long Beach at 2 p.m. It's about 10 minutes away. Due to catering, this is an RSVP event. Birthdays this week, Nancy Sansom and Richard Hoover is on Saturday. Nancy Sansom is at home after stay in the hospital for tests. Beth Rotzel and Chuck Bean are at home after contracting COVID. Please keep Nancy, Beth, and Chuck in your prayers as they recover. And a group called Christian Outreach in Long Beach is holding an author's tea on Saturday, June 3rd. There'll be a flyer in the social hall for more information. And now, get your change ready.
Since this is the third Sunday of the month, it's the Sunday we receive our noisy offering to support the Emergency Fund of Lutheran Social Services. So if you've got spare change in your pocket, let's make a joyful noise unto the Lord with it. And of course, if you want to put in something quiet, maybe paper, for instance, that's fine too. Giver of all good things, thank you for these good gifts. Thank you for the hands that collected them, the hands that gave them, and the hands that will receive them. Bless the work of this money so that it may bring glory to you, and also so that it may help sustain people in need for the sake of the kingdom of God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you. Please stand as you're able, and let's prepare our hearts for worship with the thanksgiving for baptism. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are welcomed, restored, and supported as citizens of the new creation. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. Holy God, holy and merciful, holy and mighty, you are the river of life. You are the everlasting wellspring. In mercy and might, you have freed us from death and raised us up with Jesus, the firstborn of the dead. In baptismal waters, our old life is washed away and we are born anew. Glory to you for oceans and lakes, for rivers and streams. Honor to you for waters that wash us clean, quench our thirst, and nurture both crops and creatures. Praise to you for the life-giving water of baptism, the outpouring of the Spirit of the new creation. Wash away our sin and all that separates us from you. Empower our witness to your resurrection. Strengthen our resolve in seeking justice for all. Satisfy the world's need through this living water. Where drought drives the earth, bring refreshment. Where despair prevails, grant hope. Where chaos reigns, bring peace. We ask this through Christ, who with you and the Spirit reigns forever. Amen.
Amen.
Angels, we
business. What you'll get is the Holy Spirit, and when the Holy Spirit comes on you, you will be able to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, all over Judea and Samaria, even to the world, ends of the world. These were his last words. As they watched, he was taken up and disappeared into a cloud. They stood there, staring into the empty sky. Suddenly, two men appeared in white robes. They said, "You Galileans, why do you just stand here looking up at an empty sky? This very Jesus, who was taken up from among you to heaven, will come as certainly and mysteriously as he left." So they left the mountain called Olivet and returned to Jerusalem. It was a little over half mile. They went to the upper room they had been using as a meeting place. Peter, John, James, Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, Simon the Zealot, Judas, son of James. They agreed they were in this for good, completely together in prayer, the women included, also Jesus' mother, Mary, and his brothers. Word of wisdom, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from 1 Peter. Friends, when life gets really difficult, don't jump to the conclusion that God isn't on the job. Instead, be glad that you are in the very thick of what Christ experienced. This is a spiritual refining process, with glory just around the corner. If you're abused because of Christ, count yourself fortunate. If the Spirit of God and His glory in you that brought you to the notice of others, it is the Spirit of God and His glory in you that brought you to the notice of others. So be content with who you are and don't put on airs. God's strong hand is on you. He'll promote you at the right time. Live carefree before God. He is most careful with you. Keep a cool head, stay alert. The devil is poised to pounce and would like nothing better than to catch you napping. Keep your guard up. You're not only the ones plunged into these hard times. It's the same with Christians all over the world. So keep a firm grip on the faith. The suffering won't last forever. It won't be long before this generous God, who has great plans for us in Christ, eternal and glorious plans they are, will have you put together and on your feet for good. He gets the last word. Yes, he does. Word of wisdom, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words that you gave to me, I have given to them, and they have received them, and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I'm asking on their behalf. I'm not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I'm coming to you, Holy Father. Protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my Redeemer and my Rock. Amen. Please be seated. There's so much going on this time of year. The weather's warmer, so it's nice to get outside. It's a good time for gardening or different maintenance around the house. Don't forget to clean out your dryer vent, by the way. Baseball, soccer, and other sports are kicking into high gear. Schools are having finals and graduations. People are taking vacation or planning vacations. Last week was Mother's Day. Next weekend is Memorial Day weekend. We're already seeing ads for the sales. When you add in congregational meetings, birthday celebrations, and a retirement party, it's easy for something important to be overlooked. Something like, say, the ascension of Jesus. The solemnity of the Ascension of Jesus Christ, also called Ascension Day, was on Thursday. It's always on a Thursday, because it's always 40 days after Easter. Because it's always on a Thursday, it often gets overlooked. Fortunately, we have the option of commemorating the Ascension on the seventh Sunday of Easter, which is today. The Gospel of Luke and the Book of Acts are written by the same author. Let's just go ahead and call him Luke. And Luke thought that the Ascension was so important that he wrote about it twice. The Gospel of Luke ends with the Ascension as a kind of preview of coming attractions, and the Acts of the Apostles begins with the Ascension. By ending his Gospel with the Ascension, Luke was telling us that this event marked the end of the earthly ministry of Jesus. The beginning of the Book of Acts with Ascension, Luke is telling us that the Ascension marks the beginning of the mission of the followers of Jesus. The seventh Sunday of Easter, Ascension Sunday, is a transition point between the energizing excitement of the resurrection and the energizing empowerment of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. It's a time to stand for a moment while the disciples, with the disciples, as they stood at a transition point between their work of learning from Jesus to their work of teaching the way of Jesus. It's a good time to remember the power and importance of transitions. In today's gospel lesson from John 17, Jesus prays for his disciples and by extension for us. He says that we belong to him, that we are a gift the Father has given him. We belong to him and we also belong to the Father, which Jesus would have us understand is one and the same thing. Jesus says that he is glorified in his followers. The Message by Eugene Peterson translates it as, "My life is on display in them." And I think that's a useful way for us to think about what it means for Jesus to be glorified in us. His life is on display in us. He asks the Father to protect us, and then he ends this part of his prayer by asking that we may be one as he and the Father are one. I know it's really tempting to say to yourself, I'll be one with everybody as long as they're being one my way. But what it means is that we find the way in Jesus Christ where we are all of one heart and one mind in the work of the gospel. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me so that they may be one as we are one. In today's reading from the first chapter of Acts, we get Luke's fuller account of the Ascension. The Message nicely captures the clueless confusion of the disciples as they stand at a transition point that will radically change their lives. When they were together for the last time, they asked, "Master, are you going to restore the kingdom to Israel now? Is this the time?" And isn't that just like us? You would think that after all they've seen and all they've been through, they might have learned to sit tight and see what comes next. But they can't let go of their pet vision, their favorite idea, their fondest hope. We have that same problem sometimes, don't we? We bring up our agenda before Jesus has a chance to show us what comes next. Jesus is surprisingly blunt in his response to them. He wants them to know that God's agenda is broader than restoring Israel as an independent earthly kingdom. He wants them to be ready to move out into the whole world. He wants them to get the whole idea of the kingdom of Israel, Israel as another political and military world power, out of their heads to make room for the worldwide kingdom of God. He wants their minds and hearts free for what comes next, for the work he's calling them to do. Once again, Eugene Peterson captures not just the words, but the mood of Jesus' response in the message. He told them, "You don't get to know the time. Timing is the Father's business. What you'll get is the Holy Spirit. And when the Holy Spirit comes on you, you'll be able to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, all over Judea and Samaria, even to the ends of the world." These were his last words. As they watched, he was taken up and disappeared in a cloud. They stood there staring into the empty sky. Suddenly, two men appeared in white robes, and they said, "You Galileans, why do you just stand here looking up at an empty sky? This very Jesus who was taken up from you to heaven will come as certainly and mysteriously as he left. You Galileans, why do you stand there looking up at an empty sky? You Galileans, you people from anywhere and everywhere, why do you just stand there looking up at an empty sky? Jesus will be back in God's own good time. In the meantime, there's work to do, and it's not up there in the sky. So why did the resurrected Christ ascend to heaven and leave us here to slog on without him, especially knowing that sometimes it was going to be difficult and painful? Maybe we can think of Ascension Day as graduation day. If he had simply stayed with us here forever, maybe it would have stunted our growth. We would always be waiting for him to identify every problem and propose every solution. We would always be asking him what we should think. We would be like spoiled kids who never develop any life skills, who end up living in the rest of their lives in their parents' spare room or their basement. Ascension is graduation day. It's the day Jesus hands us the keys. It's the day we become adults in the faith and responsible partners in the mission and ministry of healing the world. Jesus taught us everything we need to know. He gave us the Holy Spirit, so we're not really ever without him at all. And now with the knowledge Christ gives us, with the love he instills in us, and with the guidance of the Spirit, he wants us to master our own lives and take on God's work. We are now God's tools for transforming the world so that God's reign may come on earth as it is in heaven. Christ's work has become our work. Rebuilding the world on Christ's ethic of love, grace, and forgiveness is our priority. That means we have to be clear about what Christ's ethic of love looks like in practical terms in this world. How do we live out the Beatitudes of Matthew chapter 5? How do we learn to see Christ in the needs of our neighbors as in Matthew 25? How do we embrace the mission of Luke 4 and Isaiah 61? The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. The Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. How do we live out the values of Luke chapter 6? Blessed are the poor, but woe to those who are rich in our personal lives and in our life together as the church and in our life as a society, a culture, and a nation. How do we witness to our ethic of love, compassion, and caring for the neighbor, and even instill these values into our systems without imposing our religion on others, but at the same time being clear that our faith is, for us, the source of these values? Figuring this out, answering these questions, takes prayer and discernment. It takes time and discussion. It takes time together beyond Sunday worship and coffee. If we're really going to live as witnesses to the love, the power, and the way of Christ, it means we take time together to examine our church, our community, our world, and our nation through the lens of Christ's commandment to love one another. I mentioned earlier that Memorial Day is coming up. I remember Memorial Day picnics at Salemsburg Cemetery in Kansas when I was a kid. There would be a prayer and a brief speech by the pastor and a hymn or two. People would visit the graves of their loved ones and plant flags on the graves of veterans. Special attention was given to those who had died while serving. I remember how my dad, who was usually pretty talkative in a large group, was quiet and introspective at these Memorial Day picnics. And I imagine he was thinking of all his friends in his B-24 bomber group, especially the ones who never came home from the war. Greater love has no one than this, said Jesus. To give up your life for your friends. That truth was old even when Jesus said it. He was applying it, of course, to his own sacrifice for all of us, and the sacrifice we should all be willing to make for each other. But it was something every soldier already knew and took to heart, because soldiers have been giving up their lives for their friends for millennia. For crown and country and cause, of course, too, but deep at the root of it, mostly because they believed that it's what's necessary to protect family and friends. That's the root that Jesus taps into with his ethic of love, that God instilled the instinct within us to give ourselves to each other, for each other, in a cause that's greater and more noble than our own selfish interests. When Jesus calls us to love one another, even as I have loved you, he's asking us to find that God-given well of instinctive altruism inside ourselves and to drink deeply from it. Every gravestone of a soldier or sailor or flyer killed in the service is a marker both of triumph and of the failure of this ethic of love. It's a triumph because there is no greater love. It's a failure because we have not yet succeeded in creating a world where we care enough about each other to free each other from the devastation of armed conflict and violence. You will be my witnesses, said Jesus. You will be my witnesses that there is a better way. You will bring love and grace and forgiveness to a world filled with violence and greed and fear. You will meet the world's anger and hate with forgiveness, peace, and love. You will meet the world's fear and greed with grace, hope, and generosity. You Galileans, you people, you followers of Christ, why are you staring up into an empty sky? There's work to do right here in Jesus' name. growing in faith, lifted by hope, guided by love, and united in the hope and joy of the resurrection. Let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need.
God of harmony, as you drew your Son to your side, you draw us to you and unite us with the planet and one another. Weave your church together in a web of mutual love for the sake of the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
As your Spirit hovered over the waters of creation, so your Spirit hovers over all that you have made. Bless the water that sustains the planet, and grant wisdom to use it wisely. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You empower your people with the fire of your Spirit. Challenge activists and organizers, teachers and politicians, and all in leadership to speak a message of peace and justice. We pray for an end to the conflict in Palestine, for peace in Sudan, and a swift and just peace for Ukraine. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks that humankind serves as your body in the world, stewarding your abundant gifts. Guide this congregation's leaders as they seek your will. We pray for our staff and council. We pray for your guidance in our meeting today. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You care for all your children. Show your steadfast love to those suffering isolation, especially exiles, refugees, or prisoners. Break the chains of all held fast by systemic oppression of any kind. Comfort all who are afraid or suffering from illness. We pray especially for Ryan Graver, David Witt, Janet Sims, Diane Kyle, Beth Rotzel and Chuck Dean as they recover from COVID, Judy Mello, Nancy Sansom, and those on the prayer wall. For whom else do you pray? Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Renewing God, you gather the saints at your heavenly banquet. We give you thanks for the care shown us by those who have gone before us. Rejoicing in Christ's resurrection, we lift all these things and the unspoken prayers of our hearts to you, O God, through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. Please be seated as we receive our tithes and our offerings.
Thank you. Please rise. Generous God, in this meal you offer yourself very self. We give thanks for this gift of the earth, and the breaking of this bread revealed to us the risen one, and the pouring of this wine pour us out in service to the world. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, who, enthroned forever at your right hand, intercedes for us as our great high priest. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. And as you eat it, remember me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and again he gave thanks, then gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink it. This cup is a new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this often, and as you drink it, remember me." When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death and resurrection until he returns. Therefore, we can pray with confidence to the Father in the words our Savior gave us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We will receive communion by intinction. That means simply that you dip the bread into either the red wine or the white grape juice. Red wine is on one side of the chalice, white grape juice is on the other side of the chalice. Everyone is invited to receive this meal. These are God's gifts for all people, and we are here only to serve. The gifts of God for the people of God. Come to the table, for all is prepared.
Thank you. Christ given to you. The body of Christ broken for you.
Jesus Christ, shed for
you. Body of Christ given for you.
Jesus Christ, shed for you. Body of Christ given to you.
Please stand as you're able. Gracious God, in you we live and move and have our being. With this meal of grace, you have nourished our life together. Strengthen us to show your love and serve the world in Jesus' name. Amen. Now may the Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord's face shine on us and the Lord be gracious to us. The Lord look upon us with favor and teach us that we have a responsibility to carry his word and his way into the world. And as we do that, may we know peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
to love and serve your neighbors, to love and serve the Lord, but also stay for the meeting.
Thanks be to God.